My name is Denise Hurley, and I want to welcome you to my show, Journeys. This show is primarily about welcoming people onto the show who have different backgrounds, do different things in their life, interesting, you know, careers or hobbies or passions about what they do in their life. So my guest today is Joyce Derenas.
Derenas.
She's a historical fiction author. And I believe you're from the area, local area. Could you tell me where you're from?
From Worcester.
You're from Worcester. Okay. So you're currently living in Worcester. What's your connection to the Lancaster-Sterling area?
I'm a member of the Seven Bridge Writers Collaborative in Lancaster for maybe 4 years now.
Oh, okay. Okay. So you were involved in that group. Is that the type of group that helps you with your writing when you were 10?
Yes. It's a nonprofit, and they offer a variety of different classes and workshops and all year round. Most of them are free. A few that are very extensive might be, you know, $20-$30, but very, you know, but so I'm part of a critique group.
Okay.
And we meet once a month, and you bring what you have written.
Okay.
And you have a number of people that are permanent members of your group, and they each critique what you've done, and you get to critique their work. And in the process, you really get to develop as a tighter, stronger writer. So Seven Bridges has been a marvelous find for me.
Yeah, they've been around for quite some time, is my understanding.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So you've been writing for a while. How did you get started?
I got started... I was the amateur genealogist for my family,
okay.
And I had been on Ancestry about when it started. It was on for many years. I inherited my mother and my grandmother's photo collection, and I wanted to identify every picture I had. And, of course, these are people who are three generations before me and are dead, and, you know, how do you get to understand who everyone is? So I reached the point where I had over 500 photographs on Ancestry, all identities confirmed, not only identified but confirmed identities, and I had 1,500 people, which is nothing, because on Ancestry some people have 50,000 in their tree.
Right.
I had about 1,500, and I decided that it wasn't enough for me.
Okay.
I didn't know who had green eyes, who walked with a limp, who got caught stealing something, who drowned trying to save someone's life. So I decided I would just concentrate on one generation, and that is my grandfather's generation. And I decided to concentrate on, he was one of five brothers, so I decided I wanted to follow the life of these five men, birth to death.
Okay.
And I was very close to my grandfather, was with him many, many days in my youth, every day in summer at a summer cottage in Spencer.
Sure.
So I knew him very well as a young person. When I retired and I was free to travel, I decided I wanted to go to the Yukon and follow the data that would lead me to a specific journey that two of the men took in 1907.
Okay. So you used the background of your research into genealogy to pull together your book, The Long Shot?
Well, this is just 3 years of their lives, but yes, to pull together this book.
So the inspiration was your family tree, and wanting to know more about...
Yeah, I needed to know more. I needed to know more about each individual that I was going to research.
Okay.
And this generation I just fell in love with.
Did you? Okay. And why is that?
Because they went through so much. They lived through the beginning of the Industrial Revolution.
Okay.
They lived through a period in Canada called La Survivance. That is from 1840 to maybe 1920, 1930, when just under a million people left Quebec.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, at the time of this journey, 1907, at that point in Quebec, 80% of all arable land was abandoned. That all those under million people came down to all the mill towns of New England.
Mm-hmm.
And they got jobs at higher wages. And these people literally abandoned their extended families. They mm-hmm. kind of broke up their family traditions
mm-hmm.
because in Canada, in Quebec, they were starving.
Right.
They were, you know, in a very bad way. You know, people gave up businesses, they gave up their livestock, they just packed up and abandoned their farms. I mean, they were so desperate for a better life.
Mm-hmm.
And it was many, many decades that Quebec did not help the people of Quebec.
Okay.
Many, many of the mayors mismanaged the money, lived a lavish lifestyle, liquor and other amusements,
okay.
and mm-hmm. you know, the poor people, the little guys suffered.
Sure.
And so this movement, La Survivance, is in part responsible for why so many French Canadians came down to the New England states.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah.
I never knew that. That's...
Yes, yes. This is why we have a little Canada in Fitchburg and Leominster
okay.
and Lowell and Lawrence
mm-hmm.
and, you know, Woonsocket.
Okay. So it was an immigration from Canada to New England.
Right.
Because they were searching for a better life.
Right.
To be able to feed their families and, and you know, take care of people that they loved.
Right.
And
right.
So you found that very interesting to explore.
Right.
Right. Now, I understand. Did you travel to Canada to do some of your research?
Oh, yes. A number of times I've been to Canada. This particular story takes place all in Canada.
Okay.
So by the time this story ends, it's the scope is 1907 to 1910. But by the time the story ends, we're still in Canada. No one has migrated down yet. That's another book.
That's another book. Okay.
But I went to the Yukon,
mm-hmm.
To Whitehorse and Dawson City, which is just under the Arctic Circle.
Sure.
Top of the world.
Oh, my goodness.
What was that like? Pardon?
What was that like?
Well, I loved it. The air is incredibly fresher
mm-hmm.
than the air we breathe around most cities.
Mm-hmm.
Dawson survives on tourists, so I mean it has this tourist element, but I had to go there because I had to follow their footsteps,
right.
And this is what I was after, and I did find an awful lot of data. One of the men in my book, Uncle Romeo, is buried in the Yups Cemetery. That's the cemetery for everyone who was a member of the Yukon Order of Pioneers. So, you know, I walked in the cemetery. There's only one grave marker, and it happened to belong to Romeo's first wife.
Oh, okay.
But otherwise, there's just mounds of dirt. The
mm-hmm.
small mounds are children. The longer mounds are
right.
adults.
Right.
But, it, you know, I paid my respects.
Right.
I was allowed to go to Moosehide, and Moosehide is the village that where the Trandoshan First Nations people moved to after they left Dawson, because it was the Dawson area, or the Dawson City, was originally the summer camp for these First Nations people,
okay,
the Trandaikwichin. So they had moved their camp 3 miles down the Yukon River to get away from white folks, the white faces, and the liquor and prostitutes, you know, just... Mm-hmm. So I went to Moosehide. Not everyone can go. It was quite an honor, and I got to walk their cemetery,
mm-hmm,
and their graves, which they call spirit houses, were all being remarked. So I didn't find a second wife of Romeo's grave, but on a big billboard outside the cemetery, they have written the names of all the graves. So there I discovered about seven relatives, or related through marriage, seven people related through marriage.
Wow, terrific.
So, you know, I paid my respects there as well. So that was it for me.
All right. So the name of your book is The Long Shot. And it's based on your ancestors, which you've done a lot of extensive research about. Can you explain a little bit more about how you researched the book? I mean, you went to Yukon. Was there other places that you went to?
Yes, I came back to the U.S. and saved my money for another year, and then I made another trip to the National Archives of Canada in Ottawa and got a little more information about a second man who was second relative, another grand uncle, Godias, and where he died and how, you know, the details of his of his death. Came back that year. The next year I went back to Quebec, and I had been to Quebec maybe 5-6 times, and I would make a little tour. I would go up to Vermont, you know, cross the Derby line, and go and hit a few relatives' house, stay overnight, then go to the village of my grandmother, of my mother's birth, and her grandparents, and, you know, grandmother and grandfather's birth. So where another one of the brothers, the main character of this book, Nazaire, lived out most of his life.
Okay.
And I was doing research there as well, because they had a lovely collection, genealogical collection there, where you're looking at original documents that are 150 years old, 200 years old. You're looking at signatures that go back to, you know, 1840, and, you know, so it's exciting for a researcher.
Right.
And in this little village in Quebec, Saint-Joseph-de-Beauce, my license plate is an American license plate, so within a day, everyone knows there's an American running around. I couldn't cross the street without some stranger coming up and hugging me in mid-street, saying, "Oh, I'm the second cousin of this, of that, of that." And so so very quickly, I discovered all these people connected to my family, you know.
What a wonderful feeling.
Yeah, every place I went to have a meal, the waiters or the waitresses, you know, knew right away, as soon as you speak in French, they knew right away that you're an American, you're a stranger. And they had understood, oh, this person's here looking for descendants of this family and this family. So I had relatives, you know, connected people coming out of the woodwork. They were very welcoming and charming. And that was lovely.
Yeah.
A lovely connection.
Well, it sounds like a great way to do your research, find out more about your family, and get to go to a country you know, to explore something different, another country, another place, another destination.
Right.
That's wonderful.
Right.
Now, let's get to your book. Can you talk a little bit about the storyline?
Sure. Well, the beginning of the story, the main character, Nazaire Poulin, has had 3 major blows to him, one after another.
Mm-hmm.
The first blow is once a year, an accountant would come to the village and give a listing of what your last year's profit was whether you were a grower or a rancher, you know, whether you raised sheep or mm-hmm. had a dairy farm or a grain grower. Nazir was a grain grower.
Okay.
So he would give an accounting and he would say, do you want cash now or we let it ride? So in this year, Nazir was told his last year's profits were $10.50. He was devastated. It would not be enough for him to buy new seed for the spring, the coming spring. So that was the first blow.
Okay.
The second blow was that his wife died mm-hmm. suddenly, 25 days after giving birth. And the third blow was that his children were all taken away. And this was custom
mm-hmm.
when a man was man. Married man loses a wife, mm-hmm. the in-laws come and take the kids.
Mm-hmm.
And no one fights this. This has been the custom for many, many generations.
Okay.
So overnight, he lost his wife, he lost his children, and he's going to lose his land, his farmstead, his animals. So he has nothing, you know, he is in a position where he has almost nothing. So his father pulls out a letter that was written years earlier, and it was written by two brothers of mm-hmm. Nazir that had left home at 12 and 13, slowly made their way north, got jobs on the railroad in Canada,
okay.
crossed the prairies in Canada, got one job after another, and when the outbreak of the Klondike Gold Rush occurred, they were in Calgary. You know, they were 1,000 miles away. Not maybe you don't think that's close, but that was close. So they decided, those two boys decided that they would cross the Rockies with a horde of other people.
Right.
And they would go, and they somehow survived, and they had established themselves in the Yukon.
Mm-hmm.
So Nazir's father leaves this letter in a place where Nazir will find it, and the last line of the letter says, If things bad at home, tell brothers come.
Mm-hmm.
Come to the Yukon.
Yes.
So Nazir decides he has to go. He has no choice. He's this is the only way to reunite his children, and the only way to continue being a father to them, and the only way to save his land is he's got to grab it at some opportunity. So he decides to go. He grabs his youngest brother, who's at home, Raoul, and he says, let's go, let's go.
So they're going to the Yukon because the gold rush is happening. Mm-hmm.
Well, right. The gold rush had been on for a few years.
Okay.
But men are still leaving for the rush.
Mm-hmm. And they're hoping that once they get there, they can...
Well, they're hoping that they can
Find gold,
right.
And make some money to
right,
regain.
Right. At the time that they leave, mm-hmm. men are earning 53 cents a day.
Mm-hmm.
Women, I'm sorry, 53 cents a week? No, it must be a day.
Okay.
And women are earning 18 cents a day in labor.
Okay.
But in the Yukon at this time, and back in Quebec, they're hearing that the wages are $10 a day. That's if you're working in a bench claim. You go down a shaft and you're in a hole with mm-hmm. another 40, 50 men. So whether you find gold or not, you're still making $10 a day.
Okay.
Which is phenomenal
sure.
in 1907.
Yeah, sure.
But if you just go to a creek claim
mm-hmm.
where you're putting a pan in water and shaking it, well, you could make much more than $10. You know, you could make more than $10 a day or less.
Right.
But many men are making about $10 or more a day.
Okay.
So it's a reasonable risk.
To
leave
home.
It's a long journey. Yeah. It's 4,000 miles.
And that's what this is about, is their journey.
Their journey,
to get
right.
to...
From city to... From one major city to another. And all the perils, all the mm-hmm. dangers they faced, all the Indians they faced.
Mm-hmm.
In my book, I talk about 13 different First Nation groups. I describe a little bit about their clothing, their skills, what they did. You know, some wanted nothing to do with a white face, and others were more welcoming. A couple happened to be a little educated, or what we'd call educated in a, you know, in as opposed to, you know, a First Nations person right out of the woods, right out of the wilderness. Mm-hmm. So a lot happened in this journey.
Okay. Well, we've talked a lot about your book right now. I'm wondering if you'd like to read a few passages.
Yeah, if there's time.
Sure, absolutely.
I'd love to. Let me read you the letter that that Nazaire's father left at the table for his son to read, hoping that it would pull him out of a depression. So the letter was written in 1900.
Okay.
But at this point in the story, it's 1907.
Okay.
So the letter reads, May. Parents, we arrived Dawson, 30,000 men. Romeo robbed in Winnipeg. So we go Swift Current, then Calgary. Prairies full of wheat, horses and Indians. Damn cold. We hear gold in Yukon, so we walk 3 months. Rockies terrible. Indians guide. We hear many tongues. Every day we cut trees and build boats. 150 boats sink. 19 smash on boulders. First day. Rapids, you know, believe power. Many rivers fast. Dawson, steady work, $6 day. Many go gnome, but still gold here. We suffer for nothing. Work for foreman, 300 and good to us. We buy no extra. Here everything, 4 times back home price. We stay, make a go. Work Hunker Creek. 4 men in cabin. Come winter board Grand Fork. Cut trees for firewoods. Too cold to work in mines. Hunt moose or grouses. If things bad at home, tell brothers come. Bring mama's good green soap. Go, Diaz.
I think we have time for one more.
Let me see. Want to do the prairies,
sure.
When they get to the prairies.
Okay.
So they reach the town called Brandon.
Mm-hmm.
The whole of Brandon Township included almost 30,000 horses. They came in every possible size and color. Flea-bitten grays, liver chestnuts, rich buskin browns, skewballs, and velvety blue roans. Every kind of sock a horse could wear appeared on mismatched legs. Stars and blazes emerged like smudged paint that glowed on their muzzles as they galloped in sheer abandon. The horses would bolt at the least flash of heat-stroke lightning and run themselves slavered with mouths foaming white or crusted yellow. No trough of clear water or open stream was safe from the nuisance of their thieving ways.
Oh, very nicely done. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Where can people find you?
The book is for sale on Amazon.
Okay. And do you have a website or Facebook page?
Yes, I do have a website, joycederenas.com.
Okay, so that's where people can find you if they want to find out more information about you.
About the book and about Canadian history, my Canadian history, the about the branches of my family.
Right, and what you used to write your book. And you mentioned you're going to be writing another book soon.
Yes, and now I'm working on the story of Romeo's life and his first wife.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you so much for coming on to Journeys. It was delightful. I loved the information and the story behind the book. And, you know, I think it's fascinating. A lot of people are doing this now with the genealogy, looking at where their families are coming from and how important it is for us to connect to our ancestors. So it's great to have you here, and thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much.
All right, and thanks for being tuning in for Journeys, and we'll see you next time.